This is a 2011 Ferrari 599 GTO, and it is a very special Ferrari. Any Ferrari is special, of course, but this one is particularly exciting because it's the limited production, high performance version of the regular Ferrari 599, and prices for these are in the $550,000 to $600,000 range. And today, I'm going to review it. I've borrowed this 599 GTO from CNC Motors, which is an exotic car dealership here in Southern California that has an amazing inventory of amazing cars, from million-dollar supercars to old stuff to everything in between. They have one of the most incredible showrooms of any dealership on earth. You can check them out by clicking the link in the description below. So on to the 599 GTO. Now the regular Ferrari 599 was sold from 2007 to 2011, and it used a 6-liter V12 with 610 horsepower and about 450 pound-feet of torque. The GTO turned things up a bit. It had 660 horsepower and a slight torque boost, plus it dropped 220 pounds compared to the regular 599, which meant that this thing could do 0 to 60 in 3.3 seconds. More importantly, the 599 GTO is just really rare. Ferrari says they built only 599 of these for the entire world, and only about 125 of those came to North America. So this particular car is very uncommon. As a result, prices have always stayed tremendously high, and these are currently trading in the $550,000 to $600,000 range, which is about three or four times what you'd pay for a regular 599. And today, I'm gonna see if it's worth it. First, I'm going to show you around the 599 GTO, and I'm gonna show you all of its interesting quirks and features. Then, I'm gonna get it out on the road and drive it, and then I'm going to give it a Doug score. And for more of my thoughts on the 599 GTO, click the link below to visit autotrader.com/oversteer, where I've also rounded up a list of the most expensive Ferrari models currently listed for sale on Autotrader. All right, I'm gonna start the quirks and features of the 599 GTO with something very noticeable the moment you climb in here, and that would be the fact there's no leather anywhere in this interior. If you've been in any other Ferrari, you know they're usually full leather affairs with leather seats and leather dashboards and leather ceilings and leather floor mats and on. This thing has none of that. Leather is heavy, so Ferrari took it out of this car. The seats are Alcantara on the outside and kind of this mesh in the middle, which definitely doesn't look as nice or as high quality as leather, but the goal is to kind of keep you in place from sliding around when you're going through fast corners on a racetrack, and this material does a great job of that. But this whole ditching leather for the high performance version, the GTO, to save weight for the racetrack, also means you lose some other nice amenities, like for instance power seats, which can be heavy. This thing has manual seats instead, very simple little bar, you pull the seat forward backwards, the backrest, but that means you have manual seats in a $500,000 car, which is a bit surprising, but if you want to save weight at all costs, that's what you gotta do. Another great example of weight savings in here that's immediately noticeable when you climb in is the floor mats, and specifically the fact that there aren't any. Instead, you have this bare floor material that obviously does help to save weight compared to sticking heavy leather floor mats in there. Doesn't look as nice, but it's more track focused. And it's things like this that allowed Ferrari to pull 220 pounds out of the weight of the regular 599 when creating the GTO. One item worth noting, speaking of the floors, this car may have saved weight by ditching its floor mats, but it does come with a fire extinguisher. Ferrari must know that's a good item to have if you plan to go on the racetrack, just in case. Next up, another interesting weight savings item, the dashboard of basically every Ferrari is this nice hand-stitched leather, but not this car. You can see the top of the dashboard here is this cloth fabric material, very un-Ferrari-like. Even the airbag cover is this material, which is very surprising, but again, all in the pursuit of weight savings. You have this same material on the top of the door panels. You can again see the side airbag cover is this material, as is the rest of the entire top of the door panels. Cloth in a Ferrari, surprising. And next up, speaking of materials in this car, one interesting item is found behind the seats where you have these nice Alcantara straps and a shelf. That's for luggage. Obviously, you can use the trunk if you want, or you can use this shelf and then strap down your beautiful luggage with your beautiful straps. And next up, another interesting item in this car. In the very middle of the center control stack, there is a plaque that reads Limited 1 of 599. Usually those plaques are hidden somewhere else. This one right in the center, so you know just how rare your car is at all times. Now it's worth noting that plaque is actually mounted on a lid. You can see the climate controls are out in the open and exposed, but the stereo isn't. In order to access the stereo, you push that Limited 1 of 599 lid, and then the stereo reveals itself. And once it does, you can see there's a graphic on the stereo saying, comply with the highway code, and you have to press OK and agree with that before you can even use the stereo, as if that's actually going to make anybody comply with the highway code. Can you imagine? They open that thing up and they're like, oh, you know, I was gonna speed today, but then my tiny little radio screen told me to comply with the highway code and I agreed to it, so now I probably shouldn't. And speaking of unusual graphics in this car, how about the fact that right when you turn it on, the gauge cluster screen tells you the engine is on and shows you a picture of the engine? It's like, yeah, I know it's on, it's loud. Why is this happening? This was the very first Ferrari to use a screen in the gauge cluster, so I think we have to give them a little leeway. I personally wouldn't have done that, but they did. And next up, another thing that I wouldn't have done this way is the dome lights in this car. If you look up at the ceiling, you can see there are two of them. Press a button on the left and the middle one lights up. I guess that's the driver's dome light. Press another button on the left and the other one lights up smaller. So the driver has been given the larger priority dome lamp. The passenger must make do with the tiny one. Very strange. Not sure why they didn't just make them the same size, but that's Ferrari. And next up, we move on to the center console, where you can see these three white circles. These are actually buttons. For some reason, the top part that shows what they do has fallen off. The lower two are lock and unlock buttons for the doors. Pretty simple, nothing interesting there. If you're wondering why there's three arranged like this and not four, that's because the fourth one is for the parking sensors, but the GTO doesn't have parking sensors. They're removed to save weight, so that button is just taken out. The last button, however, is rather interesting. You press it and the glove box pops open. No simple latch in here. Instead, you have a button to open your glove box. Now, speaking of the glove box, next I want to move on to the owner's manual, which has a couple of interesting items in it. And one of them relates to the glove box. If you open to the page that talks about the glove box, it has a warning there that says, keep glove compartment closed while driving. Thank you for that helpful tip, Ferrari. I'll consider it. The owner's manual also has a couple of other interesting items in it. For example, when it talks about tips for safe driving, one of them is that you should be in perfect psychophysical condition. Putting aside the fact that I've never heard that phrase before, psychophysical condition, your psychophysical condition must be perfect. Not just very good, but perfect, if you want to be a safe driver. Now, one other item I absolutely love in the owner's manual pouch. This car comes with a CD. I think it's for the stereo, for a certain software version or whatever. Not that important. The funny part is there is a seal enclosing the CD, and it says on the seal, by breaking this seal, you accept the enclosed licensing agreement. In other words, in order to read the licensing agreement that you're about to agree to, you have to break the seal, which means that you agree to it. Wonderfully classic Ferrari logic. And next up, another interesting interior item goes back to the climate controls, which, by the way, are hilariously complicated. Five dials, five buttons, and all sorts of diagrams and letters and numbers. The most complicated climate controls in the industry. One of the ridiculous things about them is there is a button marked rest. I have no idea why a climate control system would need a button march rest. Does that stop it for a few minutes? And if it does, can't you just press off and then turn it back on when you're ready? I'm not sure, but you can give the climate controls a rest if you so desire. Now, as you're looking at those climate controls, you probably see that they are in Celsius. They're not in Fahrenheit. You can see they go from 18 to 26 degrees. Same deal in the gauge cluster. That is in kilometers per hour and not miles per hour. It's not because they built all the 599 GTOs that way. It's because this car was originally delivered to the Middle East. So it has Middle East specification, or Gulf spec, as they call it. That also means you have this label in the door printed in Arabic. And here's an interesting one. On the driver mirror, you have more Arabic writing. Now, in America, our passenger mirrors say objects in mirror are closer than they appear, but this has something on the driver mirror. Now, one interesting thing with Gulf spec Ferraris is that they are identical in regulation to USA spec Ferraris. Aside from printed labels in different languages and kilometers in Celsius, all the warning reflectors, the lights, the warning lights in the gauge cluster, they're all in the same place for Gulf spec and USA spec cars. And that means that Gulf spec cars can more easily be imported than Ferraris that were sold new in other areas. And next up, I'm gonna move on to the outside of the 599 GTO. And I wanna start with the fuel door. There's nothing particularly interesting with the fuel door itself, but when you open it up, you can see there's a little rubber piece in there. So what exactly is that? Well, if you unscrew the fuel cap, you can use that rubber piece as like a little blanket to make sure that the fuel filler doesn't damage your paint or nothing drips onto your car. That is an excellent idea. More cars should have little rubber fuel filler blankets. And next up, we move on to one of the signature aspects of the 599, and that would be the flying buttresses. From your angle, you can see exactly why they're so cool, because they're open. So while the top of the car kind of comes to a point in the back, it doesn't look like it does because it has these pieces out here that air can flow right through. Now, I personally think the car would look better without the flying buttresses. It would have this sort of teardrop shape for its back window. I think that would be a really cool design, but apparently Ferrari was having problems with lift and they actually needed these flying buttresses on in order to provide more downforce and keep the car on the road. And so that's why it looks like this. It's also pretty cool. This flying buttress stuff has become more common. You're seeing it more in McLarens, the new 4GT, newer Ferraris, but this may have been the very first car that had anything like this. And next we move on to the trunk in the 599 GTO, which isn't particularly remarkable. It's larger than the trunk in like a mid-engine sports car. It's smaller than what you'd get in like a rational, practical car like a Camry. It's a pretty standard exotic car trunk. If you do find it to be too small, remember you can also use that luggage shelf behind the seats for storing more stuff. Probably the most interesting thing in the trunk is the toolkit, and specifically the fact that the 599 GTO got its own toolkit separate from other 599s. And that's important because if you break down by the side of the road and you want to try to fix your $500,000 supercar yourself using like a screwdriver and pliers, you want that reminder that your car is more special than the plebeian regular 599s. And speaking of that toolkit, we should probably have a discussion about the whole GTO thing. Now, before this car, Ferrari had only used GTO twice. On the 250 GTO, probably the most famous Ferrari of all time, they sell for $40, $50 million when they come up for sale. And then on the 288 GTO, which is Ferrari's first modern supercar. So to bring the name back for this, just sort of a version of the 599, that was a really, really big deal, and it caused some controversy, especially because this car wasn't really associated with a race car like the prior GTOs. Nonetheless, they did it, they used the name, and this is the GTO. And next up, we move under the hood to take a look at the engine compartment, where you can see, once again, the GTO logo is very prominent under here. They were really using that. And it's worth noting that even though this car was just a version of the 599, it was also a little more special than that. For one thing, this car used the same 6-liter V12 as the Ferrari Enzo. Now, the regular 599 also used the Enzo's engine, but this car was special because it had more power than the Enzo. The regular 599 had less, and that was a huge deal. In fact, this car was the most powerful car Ferrari had ever built when it came out, and that helped earn the respect of some of the people who said that it didn't deserve the GTO name. Of course, using the Enzo engine in a supercar means it's gonna sound pretty good, and this car does. Take a listen. And so those are the quirks and features of the Ferrari 599 GTO. Now it's time to get it out on the road and see how it drives. All right, driving the 599 GTO, which was really the most insane car of its era. This was one of the very first Ferraris where they were like, we can do these high performance special edition things and charge a ton of money for them and people will pay. I just love how this thing drives. It's really, really quick. And this is the only application of the single clutch F1 automatic transmission that I ever liked. It's still not like a dual clutch, but it's not as fast, but it's more of an event when it shifts. It kind of like throws you back, but it doesn't slow you down that much. And I really like it. I think it's really cool. When you downshift in it and the RPMs rise, it just sounds so amazing. The engine note was always one of this car's very best attributes. I also just really love the interior, specifically of this one with all the Alcantara carbon fiber everywhere. This thing is just so cool. Now, compared to the regular 599, instantly one thing you can tell, it's just harsher. There's just not all that much give in the suspension. It just feels pretty rough. And also it has a very thickly bolstered seat. Wow, man, it's really, really quick. Even by modern standards, you know, when this car came out, it was the quickest and everybody thought it was so insane. You'd think some time, maybe it wouldn't feel that way anymore, but it still does. This is fourth. Whew, just flies. And the sound when it downshifts, it sounds so much like a race car, it's crazy. Ferrari just got that perfect. And no Ferrari since then has ever quite had that sound. The turbo cars certainly don't have it. That's amazing. Man, it sounds good. And that transmission, it isn't as fast as a dual clutch, but I really think there's more of a sense of occasion and purpose there. Truly amazing. I also always loved how the 599s handled. They're really, really tight. The steering is just fantastic. And to me, that and the interior was probably the biggest step up over the 550 and the 575. With those cars, you always felt the weight of the nose and the length of it. With the 599, it's not like that at all. It was just so much better balanced and so much quicker to steer and so much more precise. I love these cars. It's probably not worth $600,000 or whatever in terms of pure driving experience. But when you add in the rarity, the brand name, obviously, that's where it comes from. And I suspect these will never really go down in value just due to the limited nature of them, the fact that they called it GTO, and just how special this car was. And so that's the Ferrari 599 GTO. This is a special car and a rare car and a fast car. And in the Ferrari world, that means it has the makings of an expensive car, which of course it is. This was the very best version of the 599 and one of the best front engine V12 Ferraris of all time. And now it's time to give the 599 GTO a Doug score. Starting with the weekend categories and styling, the 599 GTO is gorgeous, not among the very best in beauty, but definitely beautiful, and it gets an 8 out of 10. Acceleration does 0 to 60 in 3.2 seconds, and it gets a 9 out of 10. Handling is excellent, amazingly precise and sharp, and it gets a 9 out of 10. Fun factor is huge, combining the acceleration, the handling, but also that noise, and it gets a 9 out of 10. Finally, cool factor, and these are cool, though they're more subtle than many cool Ferrari models, so they won't quite turn as many heads, and it gets an 8 out of 10.
10 for a total weekend score of 43 out of 50. Next up are the daily categories and features. The 599 GTO is about average and it gets a 5 out of 10. Comfort is low, the ride is harsh, although not quite painful, and it gets a 4 out of 10. Quality is excellent, though with aging Ferrari models, reliability is always a worry, and it gets a 7 out of 10. Practicality is low, given the two seats, a small trunk, and low clearance, and it gets a 2 out of 10. Finally, value, and this one is tough. It's ridiculously expensive, but it's also not exactly dropping in value given the low production, and it gets a 6 out of 10 for a total daily score of 24 out of 50. Added up, and the Doug score is 67 out of 100, which places the 599 GTO here against some other fast front-engine cars and exotics from its era. This is an exceptional car, and it's only a point behind the new AMG GTR and close to the Ferrari F12, which is an impressive showing for the 599 GTO given its age.